Welcome back to Finnegan's Garage. Thank you for hanging out with us. Thank you for commenting on these videos. And more importantly, thank you for going to fsmgarage.com and buying the merch. I have a brand new shirt for you. Today, we're working on the Death Metal Charger, one of my favorite project cars, and one of the most controversial ones. And so, we have a controversial new t-shirt. Check it out. That's right. Death Metal Charger is fueled by the tears of Mopar nerds everywhere. I'll pause for the hate to subside, or continue on. Okay, let's go. In this video, we are taking some, but not all, of the death out of death metal. And what I mean by that is we are going to rebuild the front end of the car. No more Ford F-250 truck drum brakes, no more vague steering, no more poor geometry, no more understeer, no more bump steer, no more of the stuff that in the beginning gives you a white knuckle ride that you think, woo, this is really exciting. But after about 10 minutes of that, you're like, I would just like for my car to handle and not try to run me into trees. We're fixing all of that with parts from QA1 Performance. All right, here's the plan. Tomorrow, we're going to cut off the front end of this car. Not the sheet metal or anything, but the original K-member, control arms, torsion bars, all that. We are throwing it in the dumpster and we're going to install a brand new front suspension and steering from QA1. But before we do that, we're going to do some science. We don't have the ability to run out a racetrack and go round and round and, you know, set lap times. But what we can do is prove one simple thing. The F-250 Ford drum brakes that are on the front of this car suck. I don't even think they work. What we're gonna do is we're gonna run out here on this road, run it up to 30 miles an hour, hit the brakes and see how far it takes to stop. Then we're gonna go 40, 50. We'll try to get up to 60, which is a pretty standard brake test for, you know, automotive journalism, which is not what this is. But we're gonna see how long it, you know, takes to stop. Then we're gonna redo the front end of this car and go back and perform the same test to see how much better this is. Now don't worry, still death metal. The 8-lug wheels are staying. It's gonna be cheesy. We're gonna put adapters on the front end to convert the front end from 5-lug to 8-lug, but it's finally gonna steer and ride better and stop while still looking like death metal.
Yeah, we're not changing any of, you know.
No, the Motec is still covered in dirtfish mud. You know, this car still sucks, which is why I love it, but it'll at least be this much safer when we drive it and more fun. Let her warm up a little bit. So the Motec is sending signal to the AEM dash. We have a GPS speedometer, which, as we all know, GPS is fairly accurate, but it does take a little bit of time to update. So my goal is to go down to the end of the road, turn around, get up to speed and hold it there. And then we have a point on the road, which is where this white pickup is. That's where I lay into the brakes, and then Dave measures how long it takes to stop. And we'll do that at 30, 40, we'll try 50 and 60 if it's safe. If it's not safe, well, it is what it is. But we're doing this for you guys, for science. So that if you have your own death metal charger at home and want to know whether the QA1 front suspension works on it, you'll have some data. Data. All right, let's go. I keep forgetting, this clutch is really aggressive and the 2J doesn't make any torque down low, so you have to rev it up a lot to actually get moving in a car this heavy. Alignment on this car is so jacked. Both front wheels are cambered like this, negative style, because the car is so low.
It'll stop good now. I got the sticker.
Oh, you got it?
Yeah, that's 5 more feet.
It's science. Yeah. The stickers are off all the tires. The tires are brand new. That's how serious we are about this. We went and bought brand new $70 a piece tires for this test. And we waited till it stopped raining to do the test. Okay. Here we go.
Okay,
miles to the left. All right, so 30 miles an hour is about 2,400 RPM. So that's what we're aiming for. I'm gonna go up here, I'm gonna turn around, we'll go back, and we will apply the brakes as safely as we can. All right, 33, 30, 31. Slow down a little bit here. 30, 31, 30, 30, 30, 30, and stop. Oh, wow. I think the front wheel is actually locked up. I'm surprised. All right. Dave's gonna measure it and tell us how long that took.
That was way better than
was
I thought.
Was that wrong, or did the front wheels lock up?
Oh, the front wheels locked up for sure.
Wow. That's the first time I've ever felt them lock up before. How long did it take?
23 foot.
23? It only took 23 feet?
Yeah.
All right, we'll have to go faster. 30 is clearly not enough. Let's try for 40.
Let's go for broke, bro. Just go 60.
60? All right, 60, here we go. We're skipping all the other steps.
Yeah, hell with it.
We did 30. Now we're going 60. All right. Oh, my God. I should buckle up for this. I'm genuinely surprised at how quickly it stopped. To be honest, I think the rear brakes are doing all the work, because last summer we put a quick performance 9-inch in it with brand new Wilwood brakes, and I think that's been the key right here. All right, I think the road's clear. Whoa! So it dives, and it stopped okay. I smell the brakes. I definitely smell the brakes. I was genuinely afraid about that. I didn't think that was gonna work out. That was scary.
That was terrible.
It was very scary. I think I was at 59, 58 or 59 when I hit it, and I think I hit it early. So I don't even know that that was accurate. I was afraid. I was like, oh God, there's not a lot of room here. I thresholded braked it pretty good, where it didn't totally lock up till the end. Those are pretty close together, right?
No, they're about 20 feet apart.
Oh.
The first time was much better. I don't think the drum brakes like the heat.
Well, the first time, I only got to like 58, and I think I hit it early, because I was scared. Oops. This one, I was definitely at 60, and I waited till I saw the truck.
Well, we'll split the difference then. We'll measure in between these two.
Okay. Let's go home and fix this. This thing sucks, dude.
So it looks like the front right tire locked up. That's the only tire that locked up. So now we're gonna measure in between this one and this one to kind of get a rough guesstimate on how long it took to stop.
So I'll tell you what I felt. You tell me what you saw.
Okay.
As soon as I hit the brakes, the car nosedives, mm-hmm. and then it darts.
Okay, that's what I saw,
like,
yeah.
Like, really badly.
It was kind of...
And I was kind of modulating the brakes, trying to not make it lock up, now that I know the fronts will lock up.
Just the right front. Not both of them.
Oh, just one?
Just one. Look at your black mark. There's just one.
Oh, dude, you're right.
Just the front right.
I resisted the urge to grab the drift brake.
Yeah.
Oh, wow. Yeah, you're right. One skid mark. And you can see where it went.
I'm guessing that's where you applied the manual anti-lock brakes?
Yes. And Finnegan ABS. Okay, so now we measure.
Right. Let's just tag team it. I'll measure it out, get a 25 foot where this stops. You stand there, we'll start over.
Professional. I love it. I love it. Check this out. There's two sets, right? There's this one, which is the last one.
This is the very last one.
And there's one right here, too.
That's the first one.
So that's the first one. So look, here's the first one. Here's the last one. I'm hitting it within 6 feet of each other, I'm guessing. And given the fact that they lock up, I'm reasonably confident this is where I started. So let's just measure that. Know what I'm saying?
This is way further than I thought. So this is not good. Like, we have a clear visual of where you started and where you stopped. So like, just, yeah, easy measurement.
Science. Just,
you stand there.
Yeah, all right.
All right, come here.
That's 25?
25.
Oh my God, this is gonna take a while. Okay, and I will put it right here.
Perfect. Give or take a couple feet.
That's 50? I think we went 200 feet, bro. Come here. That's 75. We went 120 feet. That's my guess.
Probably more than that.
There's 100. Oh wow. Yeah, this is starting to look like 130.
Yeah.
Okay. more than that. Alright, there's 125.
That's 150 foot.
Alright. Death metal.
So 147 foot.
Wow. It takes 147 feet. To slow that thing down from 60 miles an hour. We should scale it when we get home.
148, no, it's 148.
148 feet to stop the death metal charger from 60 miles an hour. With Ford F-250 eight lug drum brakes in the front, Wilwood 12 inch discs in the back. Now let's go fix it. I hope there's gas in this thing. Oh, we're also gonna have power steering. I'm excited for power steering. These are wide tires. Let's see, water temp is 189. Oil pressure is 37. We are idling at 1,000 RPM. Lambda of 1. I love the two-step. I love fireballs. I'm about to love this car even more. So the Motec is telling me our engine is hot. I think our drag race radiator is not going to cut it in this car. Come on, baby, cool off. All right, that's not good. We're overheating. Got a little warm. Had to stop. That's why that part of the gauge is blacked out, because we don't care about that part of the gauge. But when this screams at you, you pay attention. That's the great thing about the AEM dash, is it went red and said something like engine over temp or something. The whole thing changed screens. That's what got my attention and pulled me over.
Fan's working.
Is it?
So I'm assuming we're going to do a radiator upgrade at the same time, huh?
Yeah, I think there's not enough radiator in this thing.
Yeah, the fan's working. You leave your hand behind it, the air is coming off of it.
really hot.
Damn hand, yeah.
Jay made a comment that we have plenty of radiator, we just don't have enough fan and shroud. So maybe we have a, maybe that fan doesn't pull enough air.
Okay. Once we get the new clip in there, we may have a lot more room than we think.
So. Oh, dude, yeah, we might be able to put a rear radiator in this thing. Yeah.
Probably so. All right, well, I guess I'll follow you now.
Yeah, it's down to 219. Give it a few more minutes. Talk about the death metal charger and what it is and what it isn't. Now, from 10 feet away, it looks like a scratched up, dented up stock car. It does not drive like a stock car at all. It is the sketchiest, most butchered 68 Dodge Charger you've ever seen in your life. Let me tell you why. The front end of this car, okay, this is a B-body Mopar. It has C-body control arms and torsion bars, which made it wider, but also impossible to align. If you look at this car, you'll see it has a ton of negative camber that you really can't get rid of. It has pivot points for the control arms that have been raised up a little bit, but not enough. It is booger welded with a torch. It has a water pipe roll cage. The back of the car has been lowered with leaf spring hangers that are about a foot long that are flipped upside down into the trunk. Nothing on this car performs right. It doesn't stop good, it doesn't steer good, it won't even drive straight down the road. But I bought it because it's a 68 Charger and it looks amazing and I love it, which is why I've invested time and money into it to give it a 2JZ turbocharged inline six-cylinder engine. We've given it a Tremec T56 Magnum gearbox. We've done things to make it more powerful and more fun, but it's also exacerbated the poor handling of the car and the poor stopping. You'll notice it has 8 lug wheels on it. Why? Because it has 8 lug Ford F250 drum brakes adapted to the stock spindles and they don't work. So we're fixing a lot of that, not all of that. We're not gonna touch the back of the car in this video, but the front of the car, we're basically throwing it all away and replacing it with American made components from QA1 High Performance Driveline. This stuff is made in Minnesota. It's going to bolt on for the most part. Never forget, this car is so highly modified that one of the previous owners actually cut all of the inner fenders out of the car. Well, because this car doesn't have a frame, when you do that, the front frame stubs moved. And we straightened them as best we could. Tony Angelo and I added some roll bar tubing up front to kind of stabilize them. But when we try to bolt this new tubular K-member up to them, it might not fit. We might have to do some adjusting there. But once we do get it in there, in the end, we're going to have brand new suspension pivot points that are in more modern locations. We're going to go from a gearbox to a steering rack. We're going to have power steering. We're going to end up with disc brakes from Wilwood. We're going to end up with coilovers that are fully adjustable. In the end, this car should stop straight. It should stop shorter. The steering wheel should return to center. It should handle better. It should be more fun to drive. And it'll still be sketchy when you look at it, and the roll cage will still be best for identifying the body if I ever wreck the car, not actually protecting me. It will still be the death metal charger. It'll just be a more fun version of the death metal charger.
You know what I just thought about?
Huh.
We put disc brakes on the rear of it. We haven't changed the master cylinder, but now we'll be able to change the master cylinder to have four-wheel disc brakes.
Yeah. Yeah, that master cylinder, that's a single pot master cylinder, I think. No. Oh, no, it's not. Oh, that master cylinder was set. It was sized for two sets of drum brakes.
Yeah.
And yeah, we put a quick performance 9-inch in there with a drift brake handle and two sets of Wilwood calipers and never changed the master cylinder.
That's probably why the right front locked up on the brake test and nothing else.
Yeah. Yeah. Yeah, there's room for improvements. And it's going to happen. My guess is this is going to take us 2 days. Maybe a little longer because we're going to have to adapt things. Like we have a 2JZ power steering pump now and, you know, metric stuff going with, you know, SAE stuff. There's going to be things. But in the end, this car is going to be unreal to drive. And it's going to motivate me. I want a rematch with General Mayhem for sure. Because we got our asses kicked. Let's be real. We did. Want to start working?
Sure.
All right, let's do this.
Off subject, either a rat or a bird ran across in front of the door over there while I was filming.
Is that what you were looking at?
I kept looking over there. I was like, what the?
We did find turds on top of my toolbox, remember?
Like
a month ago?
I seen it out of the corner of my eye. It ran right in front of the door here.
First things first, strut bar coming off. People always ask about this. Oh, somebody on a video pointed something out recently that I forgot about. So this is our strut bar. It's made out of one of the door bars from Blasphemy. Think of it like a catch can. We welded bungs here for AN fittings to thread onto for hoses. The hoses go to the valve cover, which ventilates the crankcase into the bar. The bar has two breathers on it, and it has a drain hole in the bottom with a pipe plug in it. Someone noticed recently that we have these other push-on breathers on the valve covers, and we could have just routed one of those to the other bung on the strut bar, because this originally was for the 383 in the car, which had two valve covers, two hoses, one off of each. And so they're right, we could pop this off instead of this venting to atmosphere, it could go into the bar.
Yeah.
Which would look super trick and racy. And that's what life's all about. You gotta look super trick and racy.
But you also gotta keep an eye on this thing, because I mean, if we've never drained it, and if
you know, oh, it's full. You can see now it's coming out.
It's just gonna come out the filter.
It's coming out now. It's definitely time. And we can show the people that right now. Basically, the genius of the bar is when it comes off, you tilt it up, and you take that cap off, which is like a dash 3 cap, and you take that off, and then you just drain it out. You know, we just never remember to do that.
Yeah.
We rarely use the car.
We should, when we get this off, let's crack it open and see
how much is in there.
Yeah, this is for the mount to the
A-arm. It's probably got 383 oil in it too. Like, it's probably.
Oh, I'm sure.
I don't know when the last time it was that we actually. So this is all loose. I don't have to do that. That's ready to fall out.
All right.
It's as if the car knew, hey, you're getting brand new stuff. You can just.
Whoa. Whoa.
I'm just going to go buy a lottery ticket now.
Sorry about that.
That is heavy.
Well, yeah.
Oh my God. That, I'm getting a lottery ticket. Wow. That could have ended so badly.
What were you saying?
I don't know. I've completely forgotten about whatever crap I was talking about. Now it's all about just enjoying what's left of my life and being thankful that my hand is still here.
I just think if it was right there and it like just
pow. Okay, hold on. I'm going to wait till you're done before
you know what? You know, it's pretty good.
I'm just going to back up off this. Let you do your thing.
There you go.
Wow.
Oh, that's not that heavy. You're fine.
Yeah, right. Let me swing that down from 2 feet up onto your hand and see what happens.
Oh my God, dude.
You scream like a little girl, just like me. How did you lose your hand? Well, I was working on a 68 Charger that had a 2JZ in it, and a door bar that was actually in the engine compartment full of motor oil fell on my hand. They're gonna be like, what?
Yeah.
Smoke meth much? No, man, for real. That's what happened.
Thank God, dude. You had your hand in the right spot.
Imagine all the people that go to ERs and try to explain to doctors and nurses what happened to them while working on their cars. And non-car guy doctor and nurses are like, are you high? No, I'm not high at all. Transmission fell on my face. Except they would have called it a tranny and then they would have been like, a tranny fell on your face and sliced you. I don't understand.
This time, look, ready?
Car guy nomenclature is weird to other people. It just is.
I've been around cotton too long. That's what it is.
You're getting careless?
It's cotton's fault.
It's cotton's fault. Should I take the air intake out? I feel like
yeah, that would take all of it. I'm a kid in cotton, okay?
Are you?
Not at all. Yeah, as much as we can take off that's easily removable, let's just get it out of the way so we can.
Okay.
We had a fab motor mounts and all that stuff. So. All right. Mm. Oh, good. You're not, don't get under it, okay? I'm gonna pull my control arm out. Well, I said that. Let me get the pry bar. Your torsion bars look bent too. Like when I was trying to get this one out, it was like bowed up.
None of this surprises me.
Whoa.
Hello.
All right, so this side is out. Well, I mean, kinda. All right, let's see what happens when you do your side. Oh boy, you'll break the front of the car off if you do that. Come in from the bottom right here and pry up on it. Right here. Watch out. There you go. All right.
Okay. If the torsion bars were out, this would drop down, but yep. They're not out.
Nope.
Hopefully we didn't totally screw ourselves.
I mean, we'll just cut them. Worst case.
They're not going back in.
Okay. Well, let's try and get those out.
Off.
Here we go.
Ha! Ah! Imagine how much lighter disc brakes and a tube crossmember is going to be on this car. We might have to go drag racing.
We can't, because you ordered the street version of the K-member. It comes with bushings instead of rod ends.
I will drag race. Anything. So you're saying there's a drag race version of this front end?
Yeah. Oh. The only difference is it's got rod ends versus poly bushings.
Ah.
So you ordered the street version.
What are we giving up? 1/100 of a second? All right. So let's drag it that way.
Just use my man hands and just pull it out. Oh, wow. It's not near as heavy as I thought it was. Actually, it's really heavy.
This is gonna be lighter, guaranteed. What did it used to weigh?
Picture proof, 3597 right there. Right there.
3597 when we scaled it last year. And we are getting rid of a stamped steel crossmember, cast iron steering box, cast iron Ford F-250 drum brakes.
Look, these are welded on. Look how they done this. There's no bolts here. They've welded this to this. Look at that.
Yeah. Oh yeah. This is...
Yeah, this is kind of light.
This is sturdy, and yet still light. I hate to scratch it.
How many years do you think M-Bolt's been in there? 50?
All of them. Yeah. You know what's funny is I had a completely rebuilt K-member for one of these cars, and I gave it to Kibby because I told him, yeah, I'm never gonna fix up this car. I'm gonna leave it just the way it is.
Oh, hold on.
Why can't I get this to go in?
Hold on. Oh, how's that?
That's much better. Bolts are lining up, dude.
Don't jinx it.
Mine's in. Ha!
You flush?
Flush what?
You flush where the bolts go?
You mean, is it?
Like, to the bottom of the frame?
Clamped all the way up?
Yeah.
Yeah, dude.
Yeah, mine too.
Like, wow.
This is weird.
Yeah. That means... We might have gotten the frame pretty well straight when we put these front bars on the cage.
All right, I'll break the news to you.
Why so soon? What do you mean break? Can I just enjoy this?
All right, I'll give you one more minute.
All right. You just sit there and be negative Nancy. I'll be over here happy.
Oh, this doesn't affect me. The car will function. This is just going to hurt your heart a little bit.
Why would you want to bring that kind of hatred?
You get about 30 more seconds.
You just wait.
I will.
I'm over here, feeling good about myself, feeling good about the upgrade. Damn it. What?
Just peek under it. Look how low it is.
I don't care about that.
You don't care about that? You don't care about having the car low?
I mean,
she's low. She's like 2 or 3 inches lower than the bell housing. The bell housing was almost scrubbing. So, and you gotta put a rack on it. So the rack's gonna be, you know. But, you know, I doubt you'll be able to get the car as low as you want it, but I could be totally wrong, but that thing's hanging pretty low.
I'll just cut this off, raise it up if I had to.
Yeah.
You're talking to a mini trucker, dude.
I'm sorry. Yeah, let's just cut this whole area and just streak it.
It'll stay stock for a little bit. Then I'll modify it.
All right.
I'm fine.
Look how much room's in there, though.
Fine.
Look, it looks naked. There's like nothing in there.
I hate you.
Look at it. It looks like it's just missing a bunch of stuff.
Mm-hmm. That's because it is. It's over there on the table.
Yeah.
QA1 provides universal motor mounts that I can then make adapters for. Oh, man. And they're really close. They're really, really close. Like we might be able to make an adapter that comes up here and picks up the factory 2J mount. Okay, so here's the mounts that Kevin and Tony and I made when we were at KSR and we did the swap. I think what I'm gonna do is I'm gonna cut these here off the old K member, bolt this onto the 2J stock mount, and then figure out, can I reuse this tube or weld another tube to go from here to the universal mounts that came with the QA1 K member. This shouldn't be bad at all.
So I used the factory mount on the 2JZ engine block side, and then I used half of the mount that came with the QA1 kit, and then just put a piece of roll bar tubing in between and just welded it together. So let's just see. We'll do the lightweight first. Okay, all right. That didn't move. Okay, that's good. To start. Now, will she hold up? Oh, geez. Here we go. There you go. All right, it's time to install the power steering rack. This came with extensions that I got to put in here. So I'll just do that once it's on the car. But right now, I'm going to put this up in there to see how I need to attach this to the steering column. That's the next big hurdle. As soon as this is done, the rest of the stuff bolts together, you know, if the upper control arm mounts are in the right, you know, right spot, which I kind of doubt. This might be a little easier with two people, but I'll try and do it. All right. Don't move.
Key to this double D shaft is when you cut it to length, you don't want it to stick past this part, because if it goes in here, it binds up. very important. Don't want that to happen. And also, you want to keep the U-joints in phase. So this U-joint is pointed this way, which is in alignment with the use U-joint. If you were to rotate this 90 degrees, where you had the divot here in line with the fork, it would be out of phase, and it would be rotating at different speeds. This would rotate at different speed than this speed. And then you get a little binding, you get a little flapping, it's not as smooth as it could be. So when possible, try to make them rotate at the same speed. Try to keep them in phase. So those little divots that I put in with the power drill will help retain the set screws. So that, with a little bit of blue thread locking compound, hopefully keep these things from backing out later. The divots themselves will keep the shaft from sliding. And then thread locking compound will hopefully keep the set screws from coming loose. Okay, with that, we should have steering. Let's find out. And it's smooth. I mean, granted, the wheels aren't on the ground and the spindles aren't on it, but I do believe that is gonna work. Okay, on to control arms and coilovers. Okay, upper control arms. As you can see, the lowers are already installed. There's a couple different versions of this kit. If you get the drag race version of this kit, the lower arms will pivot on spherical bearings or rod ends, heim joints, whatever you wanna call them. We got the street version, so ours pivots on bushings. And then when you're looking at the upper arms, when you go to install these, they come labeled, right? But if for some reason you're missing your labels, you can tell which side is which. The front part of the arm is higher than the rear part of the arm. So this is labeled passenger side, but if you didn't know that, you would know that when you flip this arm around and you look on the passenger side of the car, that front side of the arm is going to sit higher than the rear part of the arm. So again, here's the passenger side, and you can tell it's the passenger side because the front part of the arm sits higher than the rear part of the arm. So just in case you're missing your stickers, there's a little tip. And because we're using rod ends on the upper arms, you're going to have spacers that go in here, which is no big deal. The lower arms don't use spacers because the bushings are wide enough to just fit right in the K-member. Quick little update here. The K-member is in, the steering rack is in, lower control arms are in. Now it's on to coilovers, upper control arms, spindles, and the sway bar. Then wheel adapters, because yes, we are keeping the 8-lug wheels, and then put it on the ground. One thing to note here is that we're pretty sure Joe Barry moved the upper control arm mounts, cut them, re-angled them, welded them in there. So we don't know whether when we put this all together and put it on the ground, whether or not we'll be able to align it. If we can't, we'll make that another video when we do our brake test and all that. So the goal here for me today is to get the front end of the car back together, maybe get the car on the ground and take a look at it, and then haul butt to the airport because I'm flying to Oakland, California with New Bern to go film an episode of Roadkill. And then as soon as we get back, we jump right back into filming episodes of Fast with Finnegan. So there may be a little gap between what you're seeing now and when the next video is about testing this car. So my apologies, it's just we got day jobs and those get in the way. So anyway, I'm gonna find the instructions. I'm gonna figure out how to put these in correctly and then we'll move on. So this is what I was referring to. I'm pretty sure these mounts are not in the stock location. You can kind of see where they've been butchered with a torch and material has been added in here. And I think that mount's been raised up, but I'm not sure. I don't have another charger to measure against. But anyway, we're gonna throw it all together and hopefully we can align it. with as low as we want the car to go. And if we can't, then we're probably going to be chopping these off and finding the pieces to put it back together to stock. Because this kit is designed to go on A and B body Mopars, but, you know, with the pickup points in the original locations. You know, the new K member gives you new lower pickup points for the control arm, but you're still relying on the stock pickup points on the frame rail for the uppers. And if this car was stock, the inner fender would be in here and the spring pocket, or rather the, you know, the pocket here where the shock would mount, would have come down in here, and that would brace all of this. But because he cut it all out, he gusseted this stuff, but I think he might have moved it too. I don't know. Let's finish putting together and we'll find out.
Here's the situation. Just started putting the upper control arm in, and I'm really starting to think that these things are not stock. Called QA1, talked to my man Damien over there, and he said that it should be a tight fit. There should be a single 5/8 wide spacer on each side of the rod end, and it should be a tight fit. Well, as you can see, there's probably 3/8 of an inch gap on that one. And if you look back here, this one's not even close to being centered. I can't get one of the provided spacers in here. And then back here, I mean, man, that's like an inch and a quarter or more. So I'm gonna have to make my own spacers for the time being just to get it bolted together. And then after that, see if it will even align. I got a feeling that at some point we're gonna go back and have to cut this off and redo it, because I don't think these are the stock mounts, and I think they've been raised up. But whatever, right now I just wanna get it together and get it on the ground. So I may just throw some washers in here for the time being, or make some more spacers to get the arm just bolted in. Whether it's correct or not, I don't know, but we'll go from there.
Okay. Let's install our coilovers. So these are QA1 double adjustable coilovers. Built right here in America. They went together very easily, which makes me happy. And we're gonna install them with the knobs facing towards the wheel, so they're easy to get to. They come with misalignment spacers. The small end, you want to go towards the spherical bearing and the shock so that the shock can pivot against it. The large end goes against the coilover mount. It's a little tricky to put in by yourself, but not impossible. Except when things get powder coated and then don't want to go together perfectly. Oh, no. It wasn't the powder coating, it was the bolt sticking through just a little bit. These fit together perfectly. I just gotta get my butterfingers to cooperate. Yeah, thank you, QA1. So it's head of the bolt, washer, misalignment spacer, shock and spherical bearing, misalignment spacer, another flat washer, and then your nylock. So we'll tighten that down, then we'll bring the lower control arm up, use the provided hardware to tighten the bottom down, then the spindle goes on. And at some point, we'll tighten these up once I have an idea of where the alignment wants to be. To go crazy, because it is a nylock. You don't want to just bend the ears in, because then the next time you go to service this, it'll be hard to get apart. There we go. Bueno. And now we do the bottom bolts.
Surprise.
What's up, everybody?
Kevin Smith is here because I was actually right. Those mounts were not in the stock location. And I didn't know what the alignment would be. So Kevin has a keen eye and actual tools for measuring this stuff. So he's here so that we can fix that mess in another video because this one's darn near an hour long.
Yeah, sometimes they get like that. You jump off into a project and then the snowball gets larger and the episode gets longer, and then you end up figuring out what you can leave in the episode. But yeah, I'm here, and I think we're going to see what we have to do to fix this. Stay tuned to the next video where we get into what all we have to change, because just eyeballing it, there's something weird going on that I think we're going to have to fix.
Yeah, and you'll see content on my channel and Kevin's channel. So
cool.
Plenty of stuff for Bo to not watch. Right, Bo?
But he's going to help.
Oh, yeah. More support. More support. See you guys.